Thank you, Father, and thank you all for letting me come in and speak with you this morning. So, yes, I'm an EWTN, but really my primary thing that I do is wife and mom and advocate for life. And so when on January 16th of 2015, when the DC City Council basically introduced the so-called Death with Dignity Act, I knew I had to get involved and learn what I could learn about the act, try to rally people, go down there, try to be a voice as to why this is bad. And as a part of that, I'm sad to say there are many on the DC City Council who are Catholic who actually voted to pass it. And so it passed with majority. Let's see, the council's final vote was November 15th, 2016. The mayor, who is Catholic, actually signed it on December 19, 2016, and then they transmitted the bill to Congress on January 6th of this year. Now, with the laws of DC, they have to be submitted to Congress and be reviewed, and Congress has the opportunity to pass a disapproval resolution, which is now what we are trying to do. But what I want to tell you about the bill, or these are the things that you don't hear pretty much reported on, some of the other problems with the bill. Well, we think it's one of the most dangerous of its kind in the nation, because unlike other states that have legalized assisted suicide, the act does not reference or define the term self-administer with regard to lethal drugs. The bill just uses the term ingest, which means you obviously swallow or absorb. So as a result, the act would legally allow a third party to administer the lethal dose to incapacitated patients. So for those people who can't administer, somebody else could. Now, we think this actually makes the act more like legalized homicide or involuntary euthanasia, because the person can't of themselves ingest it. Somebody else could give it to them. The act also upends DC's own statutory definition of homicide, because it exempts the actions in the Homicide Act are exempted in this DC assisted suicide. So in other words, like homicide won't apply here, even though it's the same kind of conditions. And then the act also, we think, because of this, creates coercion for those who are sick and vulnerable. And why do we say that? It's because you don't have to self-administer. Somebody can give it to you. They also don't have a way to track a complaint process. And we just think it's easy to manipulate or get people to end up taking these lethal doses of medication against their will. The act also most notably violates federal statutes. And we're looking at the Assisted Suicide Funding Restriction Act of 1996. And we think that will be our way that when we're on the Hill, as I hope you see your representatives, to point that out, that this DC law actually violates this federal statute, that they would please vote to disprove it so it will not become legal in the District of Columbia. Currently, the act is subject to appropriation, which means it hasn't been funded yet, and because it requires funding for implementation by the DC Department of Health, which receives federal funding from Congress, is how we can go and say don't fund it because your own federal statute says not to. So please remember that if you do see your representatives today, to ask them not to. We believe that probably the House will disprove it, that more emphasis needs to be put in the Senate, because we think that will be where we might get some resistance. But please let me remind them that they have a constitutional and legal authority and responsibility to exercise their exclusive authority over the District of Columbia, and it has to pass in both houses before they can block it. So we need people to get out there and talk with their representatives. You understand that sometimes you have to use language like what I just used, point out the flaws in the bill, because sometimes the moral or religious arguments may not be persuasive to some people because it's just like another language to them that they just don't understand. So if you could point out the dangers in the bill that I just mentioned, that would be helpful. Some other things that I want you to know is that there's no psychological screening required. So patients who have histories of depression or just temporarily feel a little burdened can go and get this suicide pill. No family notification is required. So they can give you the pill and no one in your, give you the pill, the medicine, and no one in your family has to be notified. There's no protection, like I said before, against coercion or abuse. And also, once the medicine is given to you, guess what? no doctor or nurse has to be present when you take it. One of the things that I thought about is how many people get medicine and hold on to it. What happens if a child gets to it or a teenager? You know, it's just not a very, this is, it's just very dangerous how they've passed this law. And also, patients don't have to get, you don't have to have a long relationship with your doctor for the doctor to prescribe it. So if you can't, your long-term regular person that knows you, that treats you, if they refuse to give it to you, you can just go doctor shop until you find somebody that will prescribe it. And we think that's a terrible, terrible thing in the bill. Now, when we fought the bill, we understood that the other side was going to try to make it about these religious people trying to force their religious beliefs on us, which really does not play well in D.C., and I'm sure it probably doesn't play that well in Massachusetts either. So we had a very broad-based coalition to go and fight against this bill. We partnered with various religious groups, obviously the Catholic Church. A lot of medical groups actually were against it. We had some professors from Georgetown come down and actually testify about the problems with this bill, as well as nurses groups. And then we also, of course, had a lot of disability groups, like the Patients' Rights Action Fund. We had one gentleman, J.J. Henson, who had the same type of brain cancer as Brittany Maynard, come and talk about, you know, why the problems with this bill. And what we started to see is when we watched the D.C. Council vote on it, the personal testimonies from the council members themselves didn't focus so much on the person that was sick, but rather on their own personal experiences of death. I remember one council member starting to tear up at the fact that he had to watch his father die. And he thought that they should pass this and make this legal so that people won't have to suffer like he did watching his father die. And I thought that's precisely the wrong attitude. It's not about you. It's about the person that's dying and we're offering them passionate care and being with them to the end, not hastening their death because it hurts me or because it's inconvenient. And that's what pointed to the very flaw, we thought, in the bill itself, is that you can have people that felt like him and say, you know, we know dad's going to die anyway. Look, I have a golf game and so-and-so. Let's just go ahead and schedule his death for this date. You know, sort of like you see the scheduled deliveries now. Let's go ahead and schedule dad's death for this date. We'll get everybody around, we'll give him medicine, and it's all done. And I think the other problem besides that is what message are we sending to our youth? I think we're very confused. We want to tell people don't, young people do not commit suicide, your life is worth living, yet these people over here, they can commit suicide. Why do we mourn the death of Robin Williams who committed suicide? And yet, under the very things of this bill, he would have been able to take his own life. So I think we have to change how we speak about it. I think in dealing with the legislators, you're going to have to talk, in my opinion, not so much always in the moral high ground, although that's the truth, but in a way that they understand that this is their responsibility because it contradicts federal statutes. And I'm sorry keeping it so short, but I have to go out to another rally after this, but I want to know if anybody had any questions before I go. Yes, Anne.
Gloria, I have a sheet that says exactly what people from Massachusetts can do, and we'll distribute it, and don't anybody go out without it.
Oh, yes.
So everybody can do something, because in Massachusetts, it's very hard for us to have influence, and this is the case where we can have influence. So we're so grateful that you came and do whatever you need.
I was very honored to be invited to come and talk about what we were trying to do in D.C. Obviously, it was a lot of prayer. It was very disheartening for us to see what happened when all the good Catholics on the council voted to pass this. But we said, okay, we have one last stop to try to go to the Hill and try to save the lives of the most vulnerable, the elderly and the sick here in the District of Columbia. And I'm excited about the march. I'm very uplifted. I'm going out there. So I hope to see you all out there as we try to bring back a culture flag for our country. Thank you.